For some of us, stepping into a third-party encounter is part of our moral code that we just can't ignore. Welcome to today's Active Self-Protection Lesson. I'm your host, John Correa. Today's video comes to us from Durbanville in South Africa. The new Mantis X10 firearms performance system has all the goodness of the original, plus holster draw analysis and recoil analysis. It's a fantastic upgrade and I recommend it highly. The original here has audio and it's kind of important to what goes down. So let's listen in, then we'll think about lessons. News story linked in the description said they're still looking for this bad guy. The store manager here suffered some pretty significant injuries to his head and his hands and his neck, and that's how this one ends. I gotta admit, the first time that I watched that guy bash the dude over the head with the display piece there, I cheered. How about you? You know, I got a poll question for you out of this one. Is part of your moral code to step into third-party encounters? I think everybody gets their own ethic here. For some of us, we just have to. I always advise caution, but I'm curious. Do you step into third-party encounters, or are you willing to, or are you just a defender for you and yours? Hit the poll. Let me know what you think. Let's talk some lessons. So let's think first of all about how quickly this one starts. That bad guy pulls out that knife and slaps the owner across the face with it. Sometimes these bad guys will absolutely use the tool in a limited fashion in order to gain more compliance. We see that not, you know, unoften on the channel. So one of these things you gotta realize is if he reaches out and touches you with it, first of all, with a knife does damage by touching. When he's willing to do that, you gotta assume he's willing to do it some more. It's different if he hits you with a gun, because a gun's not made for touching. But that knife, if he does it the first time, you're gonna see him get after it and hit him a second time there. You have to assume if he touches you with that knife, that he is willing to do deadly harm to you with that knife, and you gotta protect yourself accordingly. Now, the manager here is gonna comply. Hey man, take the money, take anything you want, just don't hurt me. Okay, fine, you know, compliance can be a perfectly viable strategy. However, in this instance, he's already been violent, already shown a propensity to hurt, and so looking for the opportunity to protect yourself, very wise. Of course, would I rather this shopkeep have set his shop up to give him a little bit more space behind the counter? And you know, would I have preferred he have a purpose-built tool like a firearm on him to defend against an armed robbery like this? Of course, but that can be very, very difficult in places like South Africa. But I think in any place that that's allowed, that that's something that you can do, that I would recommend it incredibly highly. Now, I do notice a couple things here, that the manager does look for his opportunity because this guy is rummaging through his stuff and all his money. And right here, we see the manager actually go and defend himself. He decided in that moment that he had a window of opportunity to practice the 5D+1, take that knife away from the bad guy. And he actually did take it away from him, though it is gonna take him some time. So when you're gonna defend yourself, number one, it's always attitude first and then skills and then plan. Yes, you need empty-handed skills, but more than anything else, you need an indomitable spirit that says you will not be victimized and you will not be killed in this robbery and you will come out on top. And then you gotta go with everything you have. And I see him, you know, even in the screaming in this, he actually kinda, you know, at least brought forth a bit of a warrior spirit. Now, let's think about the bystander here. I want you to go read the news story linked in the description, because it's got an interview with him. And he says, listen, I just did what anybody would do in this instance. But I really want to say, I don't know that everybody would do this in this instance. And as a third party, you've got to be willing to say, which encounters am I willing to step into and which ones am I not willing to step into? And I would encourage you to do those calculus in advance. I guess that calculus in advance. So that you're ready on that day. You don't have to think about it. You're just ready to act in either way, to get the heck out of there or to get in there and help. It takes our good guy a minute to kind of figure out, what am I going to do? He kind of puts his groceries down there and says, oh, okay, give it to me. Now you notice that it's our clerk that's actually fighting for the knife and has a hold of the knife by the handle at this point, and the bad guy's trying to get it back. Now the clerk is fighting for his life, and our good guy here, our bystander, comes in with the display case. And we do see environmental weapons, things that you just find in your environment, used in defensive encounters pretty regularly. If you don't have any purpose-built tools on you, sometimes you're just gonna have to pick something up that's in your environment that makes for a decent defensive tool and use it effectively. Of course, once again, I would strongly prefer purpose-built tools. I would strongly prefer that this guy step in. If he's gonna step in, he have a strong pepper spray, that he have a firearm on him. But in every jurisdiction, that's not always possible. So you gotta make do what he's got. And he makes it to great effect. He gets this guy hurting, and the guy finally gives up the knife and starts running off. Now they're off camera for just a second, but you can see right here in the hand of the clerk, you can see in his right hand, he actually has the knife in a short held position right here. So they've disarmed the guy. Now the thing that you wanna think about here, okay, does he have any partners with him? And do I want to detain him at this time? Probably a bad idea. You're better off just to give him an avenue of escape and let him go. And I get it. You're like, well, wait a minute. The cops aren't going to catch this guy if we let him go. That's fine. You're still in danger as long as he's there, because you don't know if he's got any other tools. And he's already shown a willingness to do you deadly harm. So if possible, break contact. And sometimes that means you got to get him out of there or run the heck out of there yourself. So the guy does run off. And I will say that the manager is mad and runs out after him. I get that you're mad, but friends, never chase a fleeing felon. Never run out into an unknown space with somebody who's just meant you deadly harm, because he could have partners out there. He could have additional weapons and those kinds of things. You put yourself back in more danger, and I really don't want you to do that. So I think that the clerk at the end of the day did exhibit some of the signs that we want to see from a self-defender, had some purposeful compliance, recognized when he's willing to use the knife at all, he's probably willing to kill you with it. And as a bystander, think about stepping in, using those environmental tools if you have to, but purpose-built tools if you can, to cover your ass.